Here we go. Everybody ready for the midterm? Yes, you are. So what you will see on the B courses site is a giant PDF that says shushies, quiet. So what you will find on the B courses side is you find two blank exams with answers, right? So you do the exam and then you check your answers. There's a new problem set. There's an old problem set. There's a problem set with answers. Who here wants more old exams? Really? You need more than two? How many do you want? See, I like that answer. This guy right there is thinking, he's like, I'll take everything you've got. Let me dig out some that I have actual answer keys for. They're not going to be as pretty as the ones that are up there. Many of them may be hand-drawn, but I'll dig out some more old exams for you so you can practice, all right? The key to doing well on this exam is understanding what I do in class and then taking it to practice problems. Problem sets, old exams, trying to figure this stuff out. Just because you understand what I say here doesn't necessarily mean you will do well in the 80 minutes that you're actually going to have to regurgitate this stuff. This is not law school, right, where you memorize a bunch of stuff and then you know, repeat it. Actually, law school is way more than that. But here, the key is on really understanding the concepts and being able to apply them in situations that you really haven't thought about before, right? That's different. Lars, is it on?
Speech up. How's this? Better? All right.
How about now? Can you hear me? All right. Excellent. So I don't mean to scare you or anything like that, but just simply being able to redo what I did in class, you're not going to do well on the exam, right? I'm going to give you random problems or modifications of things you've done, and then I'm going to see if you can actually apply the tools I've taught you, all right? I like you guys a lot because you come to office hours, and the questions I've been getting in office hours have been really good, right? Usually nobody comes to office hours, and when people show up, they whine to me about something. So you guys are coming and asking good questions. Keep up the good work. So any questions? I don't mean to waste your time. So what did we do last time? We did this crazy income and substitution effect stuff that you guys practiced diligently all day yesterday. It was a good day for you. So we decomposed the effect of a price change into a substitution effect, which is holding utility constant. How would you have adjusted the mix of Reese's to Hershey's just by facing the new price ratio or the new set of relative prices? And the substitution effect from a price change will always lead you to substitute away from the relatively more expensive good. So we did that, and then we did the income effect, which takes you from that spot where you've moved from your initial bundle to your substitution effect bundle onto your new budget constraint, and shows you what happens as this pocketbook effect takes hold, meaning the fact that you really have a lower purchasing power due to the price increase. And what we learned is that the income effect can have both directions, right, depending on whether the good is a normal or an inferior good. So if real income goes down, your consumption goes down, it's a normal good. If real income goes down and your consumption goes up, it's an inferior good. And also the magnitude of the income effect matters in order to figure out how price responsive you ultimately are. So if your good's inferior, right, some of that substitution effect will be offset by you moving back towards your original allocation if the good's inferior, or if it's given, you actually go beyond the original consumption bundle. So you've practiced this for normal, inferior, and given goods. Now there's only six possible scenarios here that one could do. I can do a price increase or a price decrease, right? And then I can do it for a normal, an inferior, or a given good. Those are the six scenarios I can do. I can do it for imperfect substitutes, perfect complements, perfect substitutes, and if I were a real jerk, I would do it for quasi-linear and difference curves, but I'm not going to make you do income and substitution effect for quasi-linear utility function because no one wants to grade that, all right? I've cracked that joke too many times, but seriously, I asked that once. It was not pretty. So that's where we were. Then we said, well, before we move on to producers, let's see if this model of consumer choice in the face of scarcity is actually useful somewhere else. So we started talking about the labor-leisure model, where I argued that your preferences are defined over goods. So instead of using Reese's and Hershey's as the goods that I'm interested in, I'm going to take two different goods, and the goods I'm interested in now are income and leisure, right? Hours spent not working and money to spend on death cab tickets, okay? So the point here is that it doesn't really matter what the goods are on these axes as long as they're goods, things you want more of. So as I go to the right or to the north, that indicates more of a good. You can also do this with bads, right, if you want to, but if you have bads, you just do less of a bad, right, and make that a good. But that's beyond what we're talking about here. So, of course, an 8-hour work week, it would be awesome. I want that. 8-hour work day is what I meant to say here. So we did this last time briefly, and I got a couple of emails and a couple of people coming in saying, well, this kink budget constraint freaks me out, Max. I can't do it. So let's just quickly go through that one again, right? So let's think about every time I say right, I'm going to put a dime into a little jar in my office, and at the end of the semester, I will buy you chocolate with that money, all right? I've got to coach myself to not say right after every 14th word. So what we've got here is income in U.S. dollars on the y-axis, leisure on the x-axis. So as you go from origin to the right here, you go from 0 to 24 hours of leisure. But since there's only 24 hours a day, if I go from right to left, I go from 0 hours of working to at 16 hours an 8-hour workday, at 8 hours a 16-hour workday, and here a full day's worth of work. You work the whole day, okay? So what we showed last time, that if wage is $10, we can write out a budget constraint. So we start assuming no wealth, right? You didn't win the $500 million in the Powerball yesterday. 1 in 170 million, I think, was the probability. But you start at $0, and for each additional hour you work, you get $10 more, right? So if you work 5 hours, that would put you at 19 here, you would have $50. If you work 10 hours at 14 here, you get $100. If you work 24 hours, you get $240. So this wage of $10 defines a budget constraint. So that's my budget constraint. And let's say Max now has the following indifference curve. Okay, I'm going to get myself on the highest indifference curve possible and pick a point of tangency right here. At that point of tangency, Max's preferred numbers of hours worked is just below 12 hours, right? He consumed a little bit more than 12 hours of leisure, and his optimal consumption bundle is A. So he works something like 11 and a half hours, and he will consume about $115. Right? One question that comes up here sometimes, Max, in the old model, the good on the x-axis had a price that was the price of Hershey's, and the good on the y-axis had a price that was the price of Reese's. You're only talking about the price of the good on the x-axis here, which is wage, right? The price of one unit of leisure is the opportunity cost of not working, and the opportunity cost of not working is an hour's worth of wage foregone. So the price of leisure is wage. But what about the good on the y-axis? Well, what's the price of $1 of income? Dollar is always worth a dollar, right? So price in this model of the good on the y-axis is always one because it's measured in dollars. It's dollars itself in terms of income. So we don't worry about the price of Reese's because it's always one, right? The only thing that actually has a real number on here is the price of the good on the x-axis, which is the number of dollars per hour you're paid. So So this is sweet, right? Max consumes 12 and a half hours of leisure, makes a sweet $115, and is really happy. Now, Max's union steps in, and by the way, this is not an anti-union lecture or anything like that. This is an example, all right? So Max's union steps in and says, well, Max, it's not good for you to work so much. You're right, my blood pressure is high. You know, I don't sleep very much, and I'm grouchy all the time, as you can tell. So we're going to say you should only be allowed to work 8 hours a day. That's it, 5 days a week, and you need to take weekends. I would have never made tenure on that schedule. It doesn't work like that. But the point here is, now somebody steps in and tells me that I can only work 8 hours, and thereafter I can't work anymore, which is equivalent to saying you'll be paid $10 an hour for the first 8 hours. But after the eighth hour, all of a sudden, which is 16 hours of leisure right here, right? So this is 8 hours worked. You may no longer work anymore, and the firm can't pay you for work. So you're going to go up to $80, and that's your income cap. So if we zoom in a little bit here, can Max still choose to work 12 hours, or 11 and a half hours, whatever it was? Well, he could, but he wouldn't get paid for it, right? So given his new budget constraint right here, which is going to be this first 8 hours at $10 an hour, and then zero additional dollars thereafter, what would be the highest point on this new budget constraint that he would be on? I'm going to have to sit for this one. I hope I don't screw this up. Ready? Let's pick green. Okay, I'm shaky. Deep breaths, Max. Ah, I had it. And then in the end, I tanked. Let's try again. I'm so excited that this is really tough because I drew these so close together. Okay, turn the surface around. There we go. Beauty, Max. So this here is I2. This here is I1. So now the highest indifference curve I can be on after I get to work only 8 hours, which, by the way, my kid and wife would very much appreciate, the highest indifference curve I can get on and still be on this new budget constraint is point B. Is Max happier or unhappier? Max is unhappier because he's got to pay for his kid's school tuition, and he's now only making $80 a week, right? A day. So the point here is, if you were working more than the new constrained number of hours, you're going to be worse off because they're going to force you down on the budget constraint to a location that you didn't pick voluntarily earlier. You chose to work more. So this new 8-hour constraint is binding. But I want you to think about it, and I'll give you the answer to this riddle next time. What about an individual that worked 6 hours beforehand, right? Try and draw that and see what happens after we force an 8-hour work constraint on that particular individual. The intuition should be it shouldn't make a difference, right? So somebody who voluntarily maximized their utility at 6 hours per day, if you say you cannot work more than 8 hours, the person's going to look at you like, dude, well, what are you talking about? I would never work 8 hours a day, right? So the point here is these constraints only affect people for whom these constraints are binding afterwards, right? After the legislation is imposed. For somebody who works 6 hours a day, telling them they can't work more than eight, it's not going to affect their utility. But try and draw that for somebody with imperfect substitutes and difference curves. Okay. Well, what else, right? What we often like to do, especially in times when, you know, the economy is good and we're building, you know, hybrid vehicles like hotcakes, we like to incentivize people to work more than 8 hours. So instead of paying people the same wage rate for all 24 hours in the day, we sometimes pay people more than that after they've worked 8 hours. So this gives rise to another kinked budget constraint. So overtime means for the first 8 hours, you get $10 an hour, right? So if we go to 8 hours work, that's 16 hours of leisure. If you get $10 an hour, that takes you to exactly $80 right here. But thereafter, you get more, right? For the ninth hour, you get 20. For the 10th hour, you get another 20. For the 11th hour, you get another 20. So if you work 16 hours at $20 each, you get $320 if you work the full day in overtime, plus the $80 for the first 8 hours, so you get $400 total. So what does that get me? It gets me a kinked budget constraint. All right? So if we zoom in here again just to look, zoom, you think, right? It's not a straight line, but there's a change in slope. I'm going to erase what I'm drawing right here. Here, the slope is 10. Here, the slope is 20. Right, so for each additional hour worked initially, you get 10 more. For after 8 hours, for each additional hour, you get 20. Okay, I get it, Max. You've said it 4 times. This is Berkeley. All right, but what does this mean for what we're trying to achieve here? Well, one more. There we go. What we're trying to figure out is what does an individual that actually works overtime look like? There are individuals that are offered the same wage schedule, meaning $10 for the first 8 hours and 20 for the second, for any hour thereafter, that actually choose to work overtime. And there are some individuals that, you know, choose not to, right? They choose to work their regular hours and that's it. So let's take two individuals. I'm going to draw two individuals' preferences on this graph, and they might cross, right? The only reason I'm putting this on here, I'm giving you two different individuals. For the same individual, different curves can't cross, all right? But let me give you Max and, you know, Lars, all right? Lars is a hardworking guy. So Lars regards income and leisure as imperfect substitutes. This is Lars, apostrophe, because it's a genitive, right? So this is Lars' indifference curve right here. The highest indifference curve Lars can get onto is this one right here, and he works more than 16 hours a day. Also, Lars can afford to go to Berkeley because he works so hard, right? So he makes money, so $260, a little bit more than $260. What about Slacker Max, all right? Slacker Max, actually, I'm not trying to make value judgments here, but I can make fun of myself, right? I don't like working that much. Money is just not that important to me. You've seen my sense of fashion. I have, you know, 5 pairs of Levi's that I paid $19.99 for. Then I buy my blazers on President's Day sale. Monday's a big day, so I have about 5 gray blazers, about 10 of these gray shirts, and about 20 of these things. So I always look the same, which is bad. I get that. But fashion's just not important to me. So I don't really value income very highly, but I really do love to hang out with my kid and blow stuff up in the backyard, all right? Which we do with, you know, we don't really blow stuff up, but he thinks we are. So I really value leisure highly, so my indifference curve looks something like this. Ah, always in the last second. Maybe I should start this way here. That looks better. Okay, so this here is Max's indifference curve. So really what I've drawn is two pictures. They shouldn't cross, right, because I've drawn two individuals, but that shows me what happens here. Max works very few hours, right? So he's somewhere at 21 hours of leisure, so he works about 3 hours, and he walks home with much less income, Are both individuals as happy as they possibly could be given this rate schedule? Yeah, right? It just depends on your preferences. How much you value income and the things it represents. Nobody really likes money itself, right? It doesn't taste very good and you can't really do anything with it, but it buys you things. So we have preferences over income and leisure. Max has a much more pronounced preference for leisure. Lars has a much more pronounced preference for income, which he turns into more knowledge, right? So this is consistent with somebody working overtime. This is consistent with somebody not working overtime. And we could mess with this price schedule and come up with all kinds of interesting exam questions. So practice this one a little bit. Okay, one thing we're interested in is the following. We always talk about labor supply. Right, the labor supply in the nation responded by increasing 3% due to, you know, Obama's new tax policies. Or, you know, if you switch the channel, they'll put a minus in front of it. But the point here is labor supply is something that we come across a lot. And how can we figure this out, or can we derive it from these pictures we've drawn here? So deriving labor supply is actually pretty simple. Right? So what we did here is when we actually derived demand, we took the good on the x-axis, we varied price, we looked at what the optimal consumption of Hershey's was, and then at the bottom, we plotted price against optimal quantity demanded. So we're going to do the same thing with leisure here. I'm going to change the price of leisure, meaning change the wage rate, and I'm going to see what the demand for leisure looks like. And then I'm going to show you how you get to labor supply from there. Okay? So think about three different wages, wage one being less than wage two, being less than wage three. So I'm going to zoom in here a little bit. Should I draw this to scale? Because you guys are going to freak out otherwise. Yes. I'm just anticipating what questions will arise. So let's have wage one be equal to 10, wage two be equal to 15, and wage 3 be equal to 20. Okay, so if wage 1 is $10, if you work 24 hours a day, you make $240. So no more overtime, you just get paid the same hourly rate for each hour worked. So this is the wage 1 budget constraint. If wage goes up to $15 an hour, you get $360 if you work the whole day. So the budget constraint rotates. If you work, if you get paid $20 an hour, 24 times 20, 480 if that's hopefully correct. Okay, so these are the three budget constraints. This is the wage 1 budget constraint, wage 2 budget constraint, wage 3 budget constraint. Now I'm going to take an arbitrary set of preferences and draw the number of hours worked by Max. So these are Max's preferences. They could be anything, right? They could be perfect complements, perfect substitutes. They could be tangent in different places as long as the indifference curves don't cross. So let's do that. I'm going to pick 3 points because that's where I want the tangencies to land for this example. Let's go here. Okay. Let's see how we do. Nice. Awesome. The whistling works. Okay. First indifference curve, second indifference curve, third indifference curve. So this individual, bless you, at a wage of $10 an hour works 8 hours, right? This individual, same individual, if wage goes up to $15, works 12 hours. And if the wage goes up again to 20, this individual works 8 hours. Works 16 hours, consumes 8 hours of leisure. So what we can do now is we can do the same thing we did with demand, right? Instead of plotting income versus leisure, I want to plot the price against leisure. The price of leisure, each hour of leisure costs you wage dollars because you're not working, so you're giving up wage dollars for each hour of leisure. And we can draw that relationship, right? So wage one was 10. Wage 2 was 15, and wage 3 was 20. So this here is wage 3, wage 2, wage 1. Now all I'm going to do is look at the optimal quantity of leisure consumed at each wage. So this highest point right here, that's wage of $20, I'm consuming 8 hours of leisure. So here's my first point on my leisure demand curve. At the wage of $15, I'm consuming at this second point right here, so 12 units of leisure. And then at the $10 wage, you're consuming 16 hours. Oops, this should go straight down. 16 hours of leisure. So if I did this not just for 10, 15, and 20, but I did it for $10, $10 and a penny, $10 and 2 pennies, and drew this, traced this whole thing out, I could connect these points, and I get out my demand for leisure. So I work on agriculture, so I go to a lot of red states, and red states hotels on channel, you know, Fox News comes really early, so I watch a lot of Fox News when I'm, you know, depending on what news channel is on. Have you ever seen the words demand for leisure used on Fox News? No. CNN? No. Have you heard the words labor supply? Yes, you do all the time, right? So we don't talk about demand for leisure, but we talk about the supply for labor. But at a wage of $20, if you're demanding 8 hours of leisure, how much labor are you willing to supply? Well, the rest of the day, 16. At a wage of $15, you're leisuring 12 hours a day, right? How much labor are you willing to supply? Rest of the day, 12 hours. At a wage of $10, you're leisuring 16 hours. How much labor are you willing to supply? 8, right? So labor supply is just 24 minus labor demand. So we in the picture on the right, isn't it like a graphing genius? I was so proud of myself when I came up with this slide. I can do the same thing, but in the x-axis, instead of doing leisure demanded, draw leisure demanded, I'm going to plot labor supplied across these same wages right here, right? So at $10, at $15, and at $20, right? So again, wage 1, wage 2, wage 3. It's just 24 minus leisure demanded at each wage level. So